being in on the sacrifice. It's more, the modern concept is more what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. But this, even the Greek, the way that this is communicated is, it's what we used to call an eternal verb. I am crucified with Christ. And the term is really, the reason why it says I am is because I was, I am, and I ever will be. But not because it is something that happened long ago and it's going to keep me dead. Rather, I live in the reality of the sacrifice of Christ working in me. And working, and the cross, and what is it now? Consider this, I'm crucified with Christ. Okay, if I'm crucified with Christ, then what is it that God is trying to work in me? Well, the scriptures tell you. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, Christ lives in me. In other words, God's not trying to work anything in you primarily in the manner of what most people think. He's trying to get us out and get Christ in. Not just the Savior in, not just Jesus living in our heart somewhere, but not as our life. So you could say that he's the purpose of the cross was to work Christ into us. All right, so all of that going along with our famous picture, that the fulfillment of, they did the sacrifices. We live in accord with the sacrifices. They offered lambs. Jesus is the lamb in us. But you know, he's not just the lamb in us. You could say, you could look at a burnt offering and you could lay the lamb on the altar because, you know, on the continual burnt offering, the daily sacrifice, it was a lamb. You can lay the lamb on that altar and say, there's the lamb. God's pleased. Not kill it, just set him up there on the altar. The altar becomes a pedestal. But folks, the lamb that is on the throne right now is not a glorified lamb. It's a slain lamb that's glorified. When you read it in the book of Revelation, it doesn't even say, like tries to communicate to us a resurrected lamb. This is a lamb that is slain. You'd think, come on now, follow me here. Wouldn't you think that this whole issue is an issue of Christ dying on the cross and now he's raised again and we go through suffering but we're going to be raised and everything's going to be wonderful? Isn't that sort of the concept? But look at the one raised up and look at the one glorified above everything else, and it's a lamb that is yet viewed as slain. In other words, self-giving nature. Not just a one-time event 2,000 years ago. If it were, the lamb on the throne would be like, he would have like steroid muscles. I am the resurrected lamb. But interesting, that same lamb, the same one on the throne, I mean, he's the one who says, I am he that overcometh. I am he that was dead and overcame. But that was the death of the cross. Long before the cross, Jesus constantly gave himself. I mean, he had to subsist came as a man, had to subsist by food, had to go to the bathroom, had to do, you know, this is God. Come on. This is God. You don't think that any of that was lamb just to put himself through? I mean, think about it. I mean, it's like God coming down here and, you know, he's born as a little baby. You know, that would be an incredible humility to God, and yet it wasn't that far out of his nature anyway. He's self-giving. He doesn't lift himself up. He took care of us at his own expense. This is the burnt offering, the continual burnt offering, the whole burnt offering. We'll get into that maybe tonight, probably not, but this reality of the whole burnt offering and this reality that it is yet a sweet savor to God by Christ within us now. So our identification with Jesus is not an identification of 2,000 years ago of him walking the earth and doing stuff. But it's not just an identification with his teachings either. The teacher came 2,000 years ago, and even though it was a long time ago, the teachings are still good. Folks, it's not just identifying with his teachings. We are supposed to be identified in his death. I am crucified with Christ. That's out of Galatians right here, Colossians. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Romans, know ye not that as many of us, know ye not that as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death. This isn't only references to the sin offerings. The majority of offerings given in Israel weren't sin offerings at all. They were sweet savor offerings of the burnt offering. The burnt offering beat everything. The burnt offering, the meal offering, the peace offering. And with that, drink offerings poured out and thank offerings and, you know, this constant loving by self-giving. God does it. It's what makes God different than us. And the only thing that makes us like him is identification into his death, and therefore identification into his resurrection body, so that we are members and he lives through us, and that nature which we don't have and are nothing like, he not only has it, but is it in us and fulfills all that the Father would want. That's why there's only one acceptable sacrifice. Whether it was 2,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago or today or right now, there's still only one acceptable sacrifice. Are we offering Christ to the Father? That's the question. Are we, you know, I mean, one of the responsibilities was for the burnt offering was to lay hands on it, and that was to identify with this thing, not just say, okay, priest, take it up there and you do your work. We'll get into all that, but there was a major involvement for most people in the burnt offering. And one of those things was, because the burnt offering, remember, is not for sin, so you're not laying your hands on it, imparting your sin. That's the Day of Atonement. That's a sin offering. This laying on of hands is saying, I identify with this one who constantly gives himself. And everyone that was offered, you identified with because it was one. And when you laid your hands on it in the morning and then it was slain, you identified in that. When you laid your hands on it at night and it was slain, you identified with it. And then the next morning when you got up and laid your hands on it, you identified with it. you're not just believing in something that was fulfilled 2,000 years ago. Jesus said, take up your cross daily. Well, this is in reference to his self-giving nature. Because the daily cross, folks, is not dealing with your sin nature. It's dealing with your soul. Well, what's your soul? You know, say, what is it? What shall a man gain if he gain the whole world but lose his soul? Well, what is your soul? It's your mind, your will, and your emotions. What good would it do if you gained everything you wanted in the world and lose your mind? What if you gained everything you wanted and could not emotionally grasp it because you lose control of your soul? You see what I'm saying? What if you lose all will to live because, and that's where I was telling you that rich people know something that other people don't. Because when you got everything you want, you got everything money can buy, and you're still not happy, that's discouragement. Somebody that's poor keeps going because they believe they might win the lottery, or they, you understand what I'm saying? They keep going because there's a hope that they're going to get some good stuff someday, but a rich person has come to the end already because he's got everything that money could buy or everything that he would want, everything he believed would satisfy him, and there's no more reason to live. Anybody know what I'm saying here? They're the ones that kill themselves. There's no more hope. There's nothing to look forward to. Well, I'm telling you that the Lord is the hope. Christ in you is the hope. Colossians 1:27. Christ in you is the hope. So, there is an offering up. There is a self-giving nature that God wanted an expanse of, an increase of. For example, before the world was, before you and I, before any human, God looked at his son and said, I am well pleased with you. Why? Because you're not selfish, you're not self-seeking. And so when he said, I want an increase of Christ, he must increase, but we must decrease. He didn't mean that Christ himself could expand, but that he could be expanded in you and me, and more of us could bear a self-giving nature to this dark and selfish and fighting and petty and pity. Petty and pity. You know? I mean, you know, selfishness, like somebody just taking everything and walking over other people, that's ugly, isn't it? Isn't it selfishness when somebody just takes stuff and flaunts it and makes everybody else feel bad? Isn't that ugly? But you know what? Self-pity is just as ugly because it's out of the same court, same tree. Self-pity. You know? Well, everybody, you know, Jesus is the only one who's going to overcome them, and he's only one going to overcome you. They need Jesus. You need Jesus. Can I get an amen from everybody? I mean, we all need Jesus. Nobody, you know, nobody has more of Jesus than anyone else. We all have the same amount, but we're not all walking in the amount that we received when we got saved. How many years does it take to walk in a lot of Jesus? Oh, you know, billions. I mean, is that the answer? Is the answer billions of years before we, or is it possible to get after the Lord? Why do you think there's even such a thing called discipleship in the Bible? You could just be a regular old Christian that came out to Jesus and ate of the loaves and fishes and heard him teach, right? Because weren't there multitudes that just came to hear him teach and just fed, right? You know, what'd you have for break? Some of you act like you ate a big meal. You're getting lethargic. I mean, weren't there just people that just sort of came when he came to teach? But were there not disciples that wanted to know him, that wanted to stick with him, that wanted to stay with him, that wanted to grow, that wanted to do this thing faster than just once a week in an hour service? Well, the answer to that is yes, their discipleship is a very real thing. But the word disciple just means learner. That's all the word disciple means. It means you have set your life course to learn Jesus and to overcome the things that would throw you. Everybody's got faults. I know that there's some people we look at and we say they're worse than I am. But if it's out of self, you're the same. Well, I'm better than she is. You know. Well, Jesus was better than everybody. And he said, he that is greatest will be servant of all. And that's not a yucky, beat down sort of a oriental version of, oh, yes, master, or something like that. It is, it is freedom in the highest to be able to want others to get the Lord, even if it ends up costing you. Burnt offering. I will decrease because the flesh decreases in the burnt offering. Right? But the essence of the reality is increased to the Father. In other words, wouldn't you like God to look at you and say, man, I'm getting a lot of Jesus out of you, and I really, it's sweet, you know? Instead of going, phew, your flesh stinks. Not because you're burning it up, but because you're preserving it. You're twisting the scriptures to preserve your flesh. Well, that's not cool. We talked about that last week. It is Corban. Right? Oh, no, I don't have to. It's Corban, you know. Jesus is going, my God. I mean, you know, he's just like torn in two because he understands what a Corban is, a representation of a gift, and the gift is the word for burnt offering and sweet savor offerings, and that we ought to do this, not use that term to get out of doing it. Incredible. So there is an offering up that takes place after the finished work. Is the work finished? Yes. But the work is also a manifesting itself through us by Christ and by his self-giving nature. So present your, I mean, because think about it. Sacrifice, the term sacrifice, folks, there was no just sort of, like if you talk to the Jews, you know, here we go with back to the shadow, but if you talk to the Jews who knew the shadow about sacrifice, there was no thought in them of, I got to be more committed. Am I right or wrong? There was no thought in them about, I got to be more committed. The thought was, I need to give God the sacrifice that he claims is acceptable. Right? Well, we know the only acceptable sacrifice is Christ. He's the only one. So they're not thinking in terms of more commitment or more this and that. If they didn't show up for one of the feasts, they knew they were not given burnt offerings and sacrifices to the Lord. Not that their personal lack failed, but they personally failed to give God Christ. Does this make sense to anybody? I mean, can you see? I'm trying to divide this so that you can see how we've made it all about us being sacrificial, when in reality, the sacrifice that is acceptable is Christ. And we enter into all of this only by oneness. But folks, and I'm just going to say this, I don't know how many of you truly comprehend when I say oneness what we're talking about. I'm talking about being so joined with Christ, being so one with Christ, that all of his virtues begin to pop out of you. And the Father is pleased with his Son, and he's pleased with you for giving, for being a good priest, offering up the right sacrifice and not yourself. That's what a good priest did. He didn't just say, well, you know, I mean, in the Old Testament, again, with the shadow, the Old Testament priest, he's not just walking down the road and goes, oh, you know, there's a wishing well. I think I'll throw God like 10 bucks in there. You know, I'll just be sacrificial. That would be an abomination. You know, maybe a Baal worshiper, maybe a false god worshiper might have some sort of deal like that, you know what I mean? And they go, oh, don't you feel better now? You know. Well, maybe you feel better, but God didn't get Jesus out of it, so he doesn't feel any better. God just got you throwing a $10 bill in a pool. You know? Well, let me just show you a few scriptures along that line. First Peter chapter 1. First Peter 1 and verse 19. Yeah, we have to go to 18. This is very difficult for me to communicate this, but I'm going to try, and I'm going to try to show you how God did this through Peter. Verse 18, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your vain manner of life received by tradition from your father, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Okay, so he's telling you what's acceptable. He says what the forefathers did was shadows. Even if it was gold and silver, it wasn't good enough. Are you following this? It was still corruptible. Now, Peter understands this because he says it just in a few verses later, verse 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. Notice the word again, corruptible. And Peter is saying to these people, there's only one acceptable sacrifice that is not corruptible. And then he says, we need to be born again of the incorruptible seed, which is Christ, not of us who are corruptible. Now, this guy knows because he followed Jesus for 3.5 years, walked with him every day, heard him speak better than most of you. Anybody planning on graduating in 3 years? Walked with Jesus 3 years. Well, you know, you got to give him that. He stayed with Jesus through the course, didn't he? Can I get amen? But he did because he wanted to get the Lord. But he walked with him for 3 years. He heard him better than we do. He spoke to him every day. He got up and looked into his face. Could feel him. You know, I mean, that's encouraging. Anybody ever said, I just want to hug Jesus, but it's kind of like this, you know. You know, it's like hugging air. You know. You know. Well, Peter could get up every day and just give Jesus a big old hug and feel good about it. But it didn't make any difference because at the end of 3.5 years, He denied the Lord and saw himself as incredibly corruptible, even though he followed God, even though he became a disciple, even though he dedicated 3 years. Come on, anybody getting this? Even though he did all of that, at the end of the thing, he went, oh my God, I thought my sacrifice was what was getting me, and it's his sacrifice. I'm corruptible. And that's why he writes this thing, even in verse 4 of chapter 1, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, that fadeth not away. This is a guy that's not talking doctrine. This is a guy that goes, look, I'm telling you folks, I was closer than anybody else. In the whole world, I was the closest disciple, and I got corrupted. And he's trying to tell them, God allowed that in my life. God allowed me to go through this horrible thing to see so that I could tell you that none of us will make it unless Christ is formed in us and we live by the life of Christ. Being born again, being, not having once been born again, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. That's Christ in you because he's the only one incorruptible. And he says the only successful, acceptable sacrifice is when you give Christ. You know, we have people that graduate from here sometimes and they go out and they mess up in the world. I don't have to go out and mess up in the world. I mess up right here. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm a big mess here. That's no shock. If it's not Christ, we're all going to fail. And because it's not Christ formed in us most of the time, we do fail. No need to look down on anybody else. Don't look down on them. Lift up Christ. Do you hear what I just said? Don't say, because you, right now you feel incorruptible. Anybody ever felt incorruptible and God just turned the dial just a little bit and you just went, I'm horrible. I'm melting. And your little dog too, you know. And you just see the horror of your own soul just with a slight turn of the knob. And before you felt like, I'm Superman for Jesus. And just a slight turn and you go, oh my God, I can't make it, I'm no good. All that slight turn, all it did was show you what you really are. We shouldn't have to have the knob always turned on how bad we are to constantly be aware of our need of Christ. He ought to be able to let us do pretty good and still walk around going, I need Jesus. Right? And so when somebody fails, instead of just looking at them and going, you know, or somebody fails you, hurts you, instead of putting them down, they just need Jesus just like you do, just like I do. All they need is Jesus. And you know what? They may never accept Jesus through you. Well, if they don't get Jesus through me, then I don't want to pray for them. I want to be the hero. How about you pray for them and they get Jesus and still think bad of you the rest of their life? And then get up before the throne and the Lord and the, you know, come to find out it was your prayers that pulled them through. You know. But no, we want them to know now. We want them to go, oh, you're so precious. I thought bad of you, but you're good. That's what we want to hear. We don't want to hear, I think bad of you right now, you're the worst person on the planet, and you just say in your heart, I love you and I'm praying for you and you're covered, don't worry. Well, that's Christ. That's a sweet savor constantly going up to the Father. It's not me and it's not you. It is the nature of the Lord. So Peter in these scriptures, and there's more, it's not the only ones that talk about corruptible and incorruptible, in this one book, just a few chapters. The man, it's his first letter. I mean, this is his first letter after failing Jesus. And all he does is give contrasts of what is incorruptible, which is not anybody in this room or anybody on this planet, it's Christ, and what is corruptible. He knows not by theology. He knows to the depth of his core that you and me are corruptible, and only Jesus is incorruptible, and therefore he's the only one that is acceptable. Look over in Hebrews chapter 9, just a few chapters over to the left. Hebrews 9 and verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works? Now, I want you to notice that this verse is actually talking about what the blood of Jesus did to purge your conscience. But the writer of Hebrews can't help but slip this in, and that is, yeah, it was the blood of Jesus. How much more shall the blood of Jesus, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience? This Spirit in which you give, the eternal Spirit, that's not your spirit. It's what's acceptable. It is the acceptable sacrifice. It is what God accepts. Christ is what God accepts. And all offerings, folks, had to be without spot and blemish. Amen? Every sacrifice, okay, again, let's look at the chart in the shadow. Every sacrifice had to be without spot and blemish. So now, the fulfillment of that is any blemished person can sacrifice or be the sacrifice? No. Of course not. You know? He made him do it over and over and over again, that every sacrifice was without spot and blemish. And this, he did that to make sure that we always understand that God wanted his son and not us offering up, you know, ourselves and sacrificing things. Now, you may give something, but is it Christ in you? Okay. Consider this. We always put the value in the thing given. But what if God put the value in the spirit, the eternal spirit that it was given in, the burnt offering spirit that it was given in, the nature of the lamb that it was given in? What if it wasn't so much the thing, but that who through the eternal spirit did this? In other words, through Christ. What if God didn't need things? What if, you know, you didn't enrich God one bit by what you gave him? I mean, what if, you know, he didn't go, oh, thank you. You know, I've always wanted that. He made everything. He can create a billion of those. Now, if you're a parent or in love, you know that somebody can give you something. You know, like my children, when they were young, they would make little pictures and stuff, and I've got a ton of them still. In this move, I've been able to look at them and weep over them and, you know, stuff like that. You know, they give you this thing, and the spelling's wrong, and I love you, Daddy, and, you know, all this stuff, and you're not going, my God, this will be worth money in the future. You're going, it's the heart. You understand? And this is a shadow. It's the heart. You know, somebody that, you know, if you're in love and somebody that you love gives you something, they can give you something really dumb and it's just like the most precious thing. And it's like, oh, you know? I mean, when I first proposed to my wife the way that I did it, and she wasn't my wife then, was I just in passing said, well, I guess we're going to have to get married. It was the first she'd heard of it. And then I got up and left, and she went. And being a poor boy, I didn't have any money and everything. And I had this cigar band, and I put it on her finger. My God, you would have thought it was encrusted with, you know, every jewel in the universe. It was like, I found it on the ground. You found it in heaven. I'll get you a good one later. That's what I said. Here, I found it on the ground. I'll get you a good one later. I was a Bible school student. I didn't have any money. It didn't matter if I was a Bible school student. I never had any money anyway. Well, I'll tell you a little story. The ring that she wears on right now, I didn't buy it. The Lord moved on somebody's heart and said, I'm going to buy the ring that you want. You go down and pick it out. And I didn't even have the money to buy. I just trusted the Lord. I did find a glorious cigar band. In the future. You know, I'm incredibly romantic, you know. And so, you know, I mean, that was, for her, that was it. That was it. That was better than the one, honestly, was better. Well, you know, it's the spirit behind it. It couldn't possibly be the thing. That's a shadow. That's a shadow. People do that all the time. They're not even born again, and they treasure that. It's a shadow of the true, and that is we give everything by the eternal Spirit, which is Christ in us, and that through that Spirit, the Father receives the acceptable sacrifice, not the thing you gave, but the Spirit in which you gave it, which was Christ. Does that make sense? Can you see? I mean, because, you know, we put we're so earthly and we're raised here that we put value on things of the earth. And God, who created material things but was way before there was anything material, knows that anything material was just a shadow. I mean, he said, by him and for him and through him, if I create a corn of wheat, it's only a shadow of the true. I'd rather have the true. If I create a moon, it's only a shadow of the true. If I create a sun, you see what I mean? On and on and on until you've created every material thing. And God goes, I created all that, but none of it is it. All of it was created after him. And he's what it's about. So we're all wrapped up in material things. And this and that. And then we're so into it that we think we're really doing God a big service by giving him some of our material stuff. Like God's really, you know, man, I've been wanting that. You know, God, I know I've been listening to music too much, and I'm going to give you my iPod. And God's going, Jesus is up there going, man, I can listen to that on the throne. You know, during my breaks. Because we think in terms of us, not him. We have no clue the spirit behind this whole thing. But him, the Father wants Christ, and he made him practice it every day, over and over every day. You give me one without spot or blemish. I don't want anything short of Christ. Always give me Christ. And they always had to give it on a specific altar. Did you know they couldn't just go out and make an altar? Did you know that once they got the tabernacle, everything be offered on this altar? No, you don't go out and just make your own altar. Did you know that? And if they did, like some guys in his home says, I just feel real dedicated to God right now. What we're talking about is the cross. The cross is the altar. The cross is where the lamb without spot and blemish was offered. And through the cross, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Folks, is that not the cross? I am crucified with Christ? Folks, was that the cross? So he says, I'm crucified with Christ. He's at the altar. He's at the correct altar, and he's offering the correct sacrifice. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. The sweet savor of what is arising to God is Christ in me, Christ through me. That's the acceptable sacrifice. So, you know, offering something for most people has nothing to do with Christ crucified, and it has nothing to do with the cross. It just has to do with a sacrificial mentality they've been taught in the church that didn't require the fulfillment of something going on in us. It's just a teaching, a Christian teaching, without understanding from where it came from and how Christ fulfills that in us. Is that disturbing to anybody? Well, it should be. Now, I don't mean disturbing in a manner of getting upset with people or whatever. I don't really care about that. What I want is, if that's the truth, I need to know the Lord more. Every time I hear some new area of truth, all it tells me is there must be vast reservoirs of Christ I don't know yet. And that makes me want to stick with Jesus more. You remember Ephesians, what it says? That we shall, throughout the eternal ages to come, be learning the riches of Christ. Did you know it says that? Throughout the eternal ages to come, be learning the riches of Christ. So you think you got it now? You think you're doing pretty good? Do you get my point? If we're going to be doing this throughout the eternal ages to come, probably what we have is like one little drop in the whole universe of Christ. And don't you think that's also a shadow? Here's Earth, a speck, and then here's the universe undiscovered that goes on and 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 on. We measured in light years. He's the light. There is the light that the sun is giving us right now was actually given off from the sun. What, millions, maybe billions of years ago? I mean, however long it was released, not last week, not 10 years ago, thousands of years ago, and we're being warmed by that now. Is there more on the way? Is there more to come? Yes. And when it comes to the vastness of the universe, you know, I mean, we made a hop to a moon that goes around our Earth. One giant step for fallen man. I mean, if we're talking about the universe, I'm not putting down anything other than if we're talking about the universe representing the vastness of Jesus, then folks, don't you think it'd be good to get serious about going after the Lord with all our heart and all of our soul and all of our strength and all of our might? Let's go back to Peter again. Let me show you another scripture, and then we'll come back to Hebrews. 1 Peter chapter 2 this time in verse 5. First Peter 2, 5. Ye also, as living stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. What is this saying? Well, I'm saying what it's saying. You and you and you and you and you and me and me and all of us around here, we are stones in a house that God is building. What house? Or that you can say God has built, but this is you also as living stones are built up. We're being built up into what he has made us by his resurrection, and that is a habitation of God. He's not just making a house, he's making a habitation for himself. You know, it's one thing for God to be a contractor that builds houses. It's another thing for God to be specifically working on his own house. What is he working on? He's working on you and me. To what end? So he can live in us and express himself through us. But let's get a little more specific. This house is also a temple. All of this being shadow, we are the house, we are the temple. Does he, as a house, he wants to live in us. As a temple, he wants us as priests, the priesthood of the believer, for us to be offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. In other words, the purpose for living as his house isn't to be Christian. It is to offer Christ or sacrifices that are acceptable to God. Does it say that? But then it gets more specific. Not just acceptable to God. We know that would be Christ, right? But he says it. Acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. It's only by Jesus Christ that it's acceptable. We're not offering blemished sacrifices. We're not offering ourselves. We're not offering our junk. We're offering on a regular basis and Christ, and we're living in such a manner that we understand that Christ is the only one that's ever going to be acceptable, so why am I wasting my time being religious when I could be a priest? Hello? Still with me? Oh my God, it's 5 minutes after 9. That's where you went. Well, once it went after, like 1 minute after 9. Oh. That's why you're still smiling and acting interested. You didn't know it was time to go, boom, you know. It's no different than a church that lets out at noon. And somebody's sitting at the church and it's, my God, it's 5 minutes after noon. We need to go, we got to get to the restaurants because there's going to be people there. We'll have to stand in line forever. I mean, it's over with. Shut up. Shut her down. But we'd never do that in church, would we? We'd go, oh, no, let the Lord have his liberty. But not in Bible school. Not in Bibles. No, sir, man. Just kidding, messing with you. I just enjoy messing with you. All right, I'm going to stop. No, I am. I actually am stopping on your account, and the quenching of the Holy Spirit will actually go on your record, not mine. Lord, do not blame me. I was going to go on with you. 'Twas the heathen in the class that insisted. Well, why don't we just stand together? We'll pray. Once at the end of a gathering like this, I said, let's stand together and pray. And I prayed like 5-10 minutes. It's about 10 minutes, actually. And somebody said to me, gosh, Randy, you prayed so long. My feet were hurting from standing. I said, do you know that I stand for 2 hours every Thursday night in front? For 2 hours, I just stand in one place, just stand. Oh. Ah. Truth is, it's easy when the Lord's flowing through you. If you're just standing somewhere, that'd be real hard. So actually, it's, yeah. Lord's good, though, isn't he? Don't you just love Jesus? Gosh, I just love the Lord so much. And I tease you and everything, but man, I love you guys. I do. I love you so much. And please know this. I'm not, quote unquote, reading anybody's mail. But when I feel the Holy Spirit going off on all this stuff, I know that he's trying to talk to somebody. And I don't know who or what or whatever, but I sense his love so much and his care. And he just, it's like kindness. And it's just so sweet is the sense that I have. Never a harsh, rebuking spirit, but just this pouring himself out because he loves so much. And I feel his love for you strongly. I'm blessed to get to experience that. So I want you to know that I love you a whole bunch too. I'm praying for you. Father, that we may grasp reality, not just my teaching. Lord, that we may grasp reality as understood in your heart, as comprehended in the eternal spirit. Lord, for it is even possible in this place to take my teaching and make it religious and not truly find you. Father, may that not happen in this place. Lord, may we all hunger and thirst, be so thirsty for you, Jesus. And may we not just sit around being thirsty, but be motivated to drink freely of the waters of life. Spring up, O well, within us. May the things of the earth just pass away as we learn to walk above the things of the earth. Lord, we can't do that without the light of life. We need you. We love you. We trust you. We look to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Run, get out of here.